We will now continue with by proceeding directly to the presentation by the Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission, excuse me, which is PMD 14-P1.2E. Dr. Thompson, please proceed.
Good morning, Madam Chair and members of the panel. My name is Patsy Thompson. I'm the Director General of the Directorate of Environmental and Radiation Protection and Assessment with the Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission. With me today are Ms. Kay Klassen, Senior Project Officer for Licensing of Waste Management Facilities, Ms. Kaiser Francis, the Environmental Assessment Specialist on this project, and Dr. Sun Nguyen, Geoscience Technical Specialist, who are available to answer questions. CNSC staff's presentation will focus on the effect the information provided by OPG had on the cumulative effects assessment. CNSC staff did review the information to determine the impact the information had on the current license application. Should OPG apply to expand the facility sometime in the future, CNSC staff would initiate the regulatory process at that time. And this would include an environmental assessment and a review of the license application. I will now ask Ms. Klassen to continue with the presentation.
Good morning. My name is Kay Klassen. EIS 12512 concerns the possible expansion of the DGR project for additional low and intermediate level radioactive waste resulting from future decommissioning of OPG-owned reactors in the context of cumulative effects assessment from the EIS guidelines. The presentation will provide related background information, a summary of the JRP's information request to OPG, the main points of OPG's response, the basis on which CNSC staff assessed the response, and the results of our review. CNSC staff's assessment of this of the impact of this additional information on our 2013 EIS and licensing PMDs to the panel will also be discussed. To provide some background information, OPG's project description was submitted to the CNSC in late 2005 to initiate the environmental assessment process under the Canadian Environmental Assessment Act. The project description was for a geologic repository for the long-term management of low and intermediate level radioactive waste from OPG-owned or operated nuclear power reactors in Ontario. The size of the repository was identified as approximately 200,000 cubic meters in placed volume of waste. The description also acknowledged that if the DGR was permitted to be constructed and then allowed to operate, that sometime in the future, OPG may want to develop a project to expand the repository for about an additional 200,000 cubic meters in placed volume of low and intermediate level waste from decommissioning activities for OPG-owned nuclear power reactors. In 2011, an EIS and license application to prepare a site and construct the DGR project was submitted. About half of the waste already in storage at OPG's Western Waste Management Facility at the Bruce site is at the Bruce site, and the remainder is expected to be generated over the remaining period of planned operation and refurbishment of OPG's owned reactors. The expansion of the DGR is not part of the current proposed DGR project and is not included in the license application being considered for to construct the DGR project. Expansion of the DGR facility in approximately 2055 for additional wastes has been assessed in the EIS under cumulative effects as a reasonably foreseeable project, one identified in OPG's agreement with the municipality of Kincardine. In OPG's 2012 business plan, the Pickering commercial operations were identified as ending in approximately 2020, with the expected transition to storage and surveillance phases from 2021 to 2051, and then the decommissioning phase from around 2051 to 2064. The operational plans for the shutdown and transition to storage and surveillance at Pickering are still in development. Following the JRP hearings in the fall of 2013, the Joint Review Panel issued a series of related information requests, EIS 12512 plus Part A and Part B, asking for further information on the possible expansion of the DGR, and the information request included the layout of the expanded facility and changes to the DGR project surface and subsurface layout, the facilities and structures, the decommissioning waste description, and the timeline for a possible project. Also, the implications to pre- and post-closure safety, sequencing and mitigation measures, and the identification of the radionuclides important in the assessment of post-closure disruptive scenarios for an expanded facility. OPG's response was that the expanded DGR project would include two more underground panels located in parallel to the currently planned ones for an additional 200,000 cubic meters or so of emplaced waste. The surface area for the expansion concept would remain within the proposed DGR fence project fence line and would use the existing DGR project surface and underground systems and facilities to construct for construction of the expansion and then operation of the expanded facility. OPG also expects to apply proven and applicable mitigations from the DGR project to the expansion construction and operational activities. OPG also provided information that described the low and intermediate level radioactive waste that would be generated from decommissioning activities. The waste material includes expected low-level gloves, Tyvek covers, and other materials associated with workers at nuclear power plants, plus concrete pressure tubes, calandria tubes, and end fittings. That waste is similar in its general description to waste from operation, but with more concrete and metal content. It also does not include ion exchange resin waste, as they are associated with operations and are dealt with as operational wastes. OPG described the different early and late timelines for the receipt of waste arising from decommissioning activities, identifying construction could commence as early as 2040 or as late as 2068 and last approximately 4 years. OPG also described the possible sequencing of waste panel use, identifying that if construction occurred early, it was possible that waste from both operational and decommissioning activities could be stored together in the early scenario. The placement of operational waste would be ceased during construction of the extra panels. OPG's response included the information requested regarding the implications of an expanded DGR on both pre- and post-closure safety. OPG discussed the effects of changes in timeline, the characteristics and inventory of the waste from decommissioning activities, possible mitigations such as decontamination and recycling of low-level metal, additional decay time, and additional shielding, the application of experience from the DGR project, possible mitigations of containers to meet the radiation protection requirements, and further sampling and testing of bedrock as needed near the area of the expansion. I will now pass the presentation to Ms. Kaiser Francis to discuss CNSC staff's review of OPG's response.
Thank you. For the record, my name is Kaiser Francis. I am the Environmental Assessment Specialist on this file. The information provided by OPG in response to this information request was used by CNSC staff to confirm the cumulative effects assessment review. As per the Canadian Environmental Assessment Act, a cumulative effects assessment is completed by first considering the predicted residual effects of a proposed project, then examining the overlap in time, space, and type of effect of past and existing projects, planned projects, and reasonably foreseeable future projects with the predicted residual effects of the currently proposed project. The assessment takes the predicted residual effects and looks at the overlap, then identifies if, in areas of overlap, there are any cumulative adverse impacts. If any cumulative adverse impacts are identified, a determination of their significance is completed. Using that approach, CNSC staff's review of OPG's response considered whether the response identified material changes in the reasonably foreseeable expansion from what was originally described and assessed in the EIS. The review also considered whether the identified changes resulted in differences in the overlap of time, space, and type of effect with the predicted DGR project residual effects. Finally, if the differences affected the cumulative effects assessment in the EIS and CNSC staff's assessment of it as presented in PMD 13P1.3. CNSC staff's review of OPG's responses found that the response provided further details and clarifications on the possible DGR expansion relative to what was described and assessed in the EIS. Having said that, there were no changes in the general physical description of the expansion concept relative to what was included in the cumulative effects assessment of the EIS. The use of existing surface and underground facilities, the expanded waste rock area would increase in surface area and would be higher, but remains within the existing fence line, and there are no expected changes to the size of the surface water management pond. There are no changes in the general construction activity of the expansion concept from that already considered in cumulative effects assessment of the EIS, including the controls and mitigations necessary to address process water, worker safety, environmental protection, and environmental protection should be much like those in use during underground development of the proposed DGR project. The expansion will benefit from the mitigations and monitored performance of the DGR project during its construction and implement best practices. No changes in the general operational activities for the expansion concept from that already considered in the cumulative effects assessment of the EIS. Waste received following expansion will be required to meet the existing waste acceptance criteria. Radiation dose within the facility and at the fence line will be required to conform to the existing radiation protection requirements, and operational releases from the facility are not expected to change. It is important to identify that all projects are staged developments. The level of detail associated with a possible future project would also be less and more conceptualized at this time, the more distant the future project is. Other information reviewed by CNSC staff related to the timeline of the expansion and sequencing of panel use. The expansion could commence as early as 2040 or as late as 2068. Expansion activities remain similarly overlapped with other planned and foreseeable projects in the cumulative effects assessment, regardless of the early or late development of the expansion. If the expansion occurred earlier, the sequencing of the use of waste panels could change, and it is possible that waste from operational activities and decommissioning activities could be placed in waste panels together. The nature of the waste emplacement activities is not expected to change, but it is important to ensure that the length of time that rooms remain open is minimized. The effect of opening the space for additional wastes early means increased inspections during operation to assess ground support safety and implement any associated maintenance. Therefore, CNSC staff would expect planning of the sequencing to take this into consideration. The waste panels would still be closed once they are full to reduce the possibility of any radioactive releases and to protect workers. The timing of the decommissioning and closure of the DGR facility will remain unchanged and would still occur in approximately 2100. The timing and sequencing does not result in real changes to what was considered in the EIS. The response by OPG provided clarifications on possible effects of the expansion on pre-closure safety. The additional information covered topics such as the waste characteristics and inventory, radiation protection requirements, and package shielding. OPG has identified that pre-closure safety would need to include consideration of the reactor history and the decay period that would affect the level of radioactivity in the waste from decommissioning activities. It could impact radiation protection requirements for worker safety, including the need for overpacking and shielding to address waste acceptance criteria for emplacement in the DGR. With the required application of the radiation protection requirements and waste acceptance criteria, worker dose would remain controlled and CNSC regulatory requirements would continue to be met. Operation of an expanded facility would also have benefited from the operational experience, or OPEX, of the DGR. The responses by OPG also provided clarification on possible effects on post-closure safety of the expanded repository concept. As the waste that would be added to the repository are expected to contain more metals, more gas could be generated by anaerobic metal corrosion and possibly impact the long-term safety case. As a large quantity of metal is surface contaminated, low-level waste, metal may be minimized by decontamination and recycling, and by a reduction in the use of metal containers in favor of concrete ones. Therefore, these concerns at the time of a license application for expansion construction are expected to be managed by control of the waste and by having additional information on the geosphere from further testing and research over the operation of the DGR project. Information from detailed decommissioning planning for the reactors would include radiological surveys to support decommissioning activities. This information would be used to develop the radiological and chemical inventory necessary to conduct the safety assessments for expanded repository performance. In the long term, the expansion would add to the total inventory in the repository, resulting in an approximate doubling of the calculated peak dose, which remains five orders of magnitude well below the dose criterion of 0.3 millisieverts. The cumulative effects assessment for the construction of a possible expansion indicates no change to the proposed construction activities. Noise and dust effects will be reduced by established mitigations. Furthermore, the activities on the Bruce site would be similar at any of the proposed timings of the expansion. Therefore, CNSC staff has concluded that there has been no changes associated with assessing construction of the expansion with the DGR project in the cumulative effects assessment. Similarly, with operations, there are no appreciable changes projected, as there continues to be similar activities and similar effects. The mitigations to address waste and sequencing differences are understood so that activities remain within regulatory requirements. For post-closure safety, the safety case will be better defined by the reduction of uncertainties over the operational period of the DGR project, and projected issues with gas generation can be addressed by waste management practices. In the current safety case, gas generation was conservatively assessed. An expanded DGR is expected to remain within the bounding safety margins. With respect to closure and post-closure, no change in concept performance is expected. Turning to the impact that the new information has on CNSC staff's assessment of cumulative effects in PMD 13P1.3, OPG's response clarified possible changes in timelines, description of the waste, mitigation for pre- and post-closure safety. Having said that, the clarifications did not change the impacts of the DGR project relative to the conceptual expansion that was described in the EIS. The expansion of the DGR project remains a reasonably foreseeable project, adequately described and assessed conceptually for the purposes of a cumulative effects assessment. And the information in PMD 13P1.3 remains valid. No likely adverse cumulative effects on the environment from the DGR project. The impact that the new information has on CNSC staff's assessment of the license application confirmed that the expansion is not part of OPG's license application for site preparation and construction, and that the information in PMD 13P1.2 remains valid. CNSC staff remain satisfied that OPG is qualified and will make adequate provisions to protect persons and the environment. In the event that OPG would want to move forward with an expansion, an application for a license and an environmental assessment would need to be conducted. That concludes CNSC staff's presentation. We are available to answer any questions the panel might have.
Thank you.